Hey guys, and welcome back to my YouTube channel. For anyone who doesn't know who I am, my name is Leah. And I'm a cancer survivor. This is a topic I've tried to share for the past 6 months. And honestly have kept deleting them as I felt that cancer, excuse me, has made me feel weak and that my story didn't matter. That was until one of my dancers asked to do a report on me, and being in the dance world and being in dance class, I figured it was on dance. So I told her to write down her questions so that I really could answer them at home, opposed to trying to rush in between classes to give her answers. And when she handed me the sheet of paper and I read the first question, I realized it wasn't about dance and it was about my story and my journey and how I've overcome such a bad circumstance. I honestly was moved and taken back. As much as I really thought I've passed all this, I honestly haven't. There's a lot of emotions up and down that you go through day to day, even being 2.5 years later. So this really got me thinking that maybe, just maybe, I could help someone else either going through this or help prevent someone from getting cervical cancer. Sorry for the quick change there. I got a little cold. So again, I tried to make this video many times today. Just a little disclaimer before we get any further into this video. I just want to remind you, this is my story. This is what I've gone through in the past 2.5 years. Not all situations are the same. Not everyone's outcome is the same as mine. This is just my story and my journey through surviving cervical cancer. It all started back in September of 2014 when I went to a doctor's appointment at my doctor's office for my annual screening. It's as easy as a swab, and I've always shown signs of abnormal cells, but to most people, abnormal cells can be someone's normal cells. That was my case. My abnormal cells for the past years, as much as I went checked yearly just to make sure, had never come back to even send me to the gynecologist. A week later, I get a phone call from my doctor saying she was sending me to the gynecologist as my cells were not good. I get to the gynecologist and the gynecologist says, "You know why you're here?" And I said, "Well, I think to have a biopsy to have a closer look at my cells." And she said, "Yes, but you know the type of cells that you were showing signs of?" And I said, "No." And she told me, "You're showing signs of glandular cells." Now, glandular cells are usually found over women who are over 40 and only really has been, I guess, come known in the past 10 years. First, I was 29. It's unheard of to have someone my age have those type of cells. Most people have cells that will produce on the outside of the cervix, which is usually caused by HPV. and they can eventually produce cancer cells. Glandular cells are found along the line of the uterus usually and work their way down to the opening of the cervix. Done, and she did a look and she couldn't find any of the cells at the time. She told me for 2 years I would be coming to see her for every 6 months. So fast forward 6 months, I go in. She says, okay, this time I do see something, I am going to take a biopsy. I scheduled to get my results the 1st of June, May 12th, 2015. I'm sitting at work and I get a private number phone call, it being my doctor, telling me that she removed cancer. But in 6 months, I went from having abnormal cells that they can't find anywhere to having cancer. It's really hard to say what my initial reaction was. I believe once the word cancer came out of her mouth, part of me was like, okay, the outsides are negative, she's got it all, I'm good. You know, that's why we go for these tests. I'm good, this is great, you know, thank God. And that's kind of what was playing through my mind until she kept talking about surgery. And we're gonna have to get you in for surgery. You know, time is of the essence. And it took her about 8 times before I realized, and I said, well, what do you mean cancer? She said, the types of cells that you have will continuously produce cancer, or I should say cancerous tumors, and if not taken care of, could kill you. And I said, well, what about chemo? Why do I need to, you know, have surgery? Can I fight it with chemo and fight off the cell? She said, from all this that has been done before, the best source to prevent this is to have a partial hysterectomy. Only leaving my ovaries. This is when the shock set in. I remember sitting there realizing my only chance to have a child just was flown out the window. That I had cancer. That my life was never going to be the same. Then it gets us into the uncontrollably crying, a lot of nervous breakdowns, and not knowing where the future held, or sorry, what the future held. Thinking that I was gonna wake up and that I was dreaming. I think the mental side of it, of knowing I can't. can never produce my own child or carry my own child. It's played a bigger role in my life than I thought. I think to this day, there's still a side of me that's shocked that, you know, all of a sudden I'm magical and gonna have organs and, hey, I'm pregnant. I'm not that dumb. I can go through surrogacy. But the mental side of someone else carrying my child breaks my heart at the same time. I've thought about adoption, but it's a very difficult one for me as well. I go back and forth a lot. Some days I really do, and some days the mental aspect of it just pushes me back down. Afterthought, 100%, I was gonna beat this right away. My afterthought was there was two options I was given. I could remove my cervix by flying to Toronto, leaving everything else, having a child, and then going in afterwards, probably being full of cancer, and then do the rest of the hysterectomy. Being sick as soon as your child is born, being selfish just to have your own baby, and possibly leave my husband on his own. To say it didn't cross my mind. But then I remember now is not the time to be selfish. It's the time to fight to live. So it led me to option two, have the partial hysterectomy, have the removal of my lymph nodes in my groinal area, have them tested to make sure the cancer has not spread through my bloodstream. And I think it was the afterthought of, did I make the right decision? You know, were they lying when they said that I only have an allotted time, that it's going to come back? Are they just rushing this because, can it wait? It can't grow that fast. This one took 6 months. You know, all those games your mind plays on you. To waking up from surgery for the doctor to tell me he indeed removed another tumor. It was cancerous. So instead of having a small incision, I had a big incision hip to hip because it cleaned out the area to prevent it. The good news was it wasn't in my lymph nodes, so it was contained in my reproductive organs, and that afterthought clearly became, I made the right call and gave me peace of mind. Again, I didn't have to go through anything besides the surgery. I go for checkups every, the first 2 years was every 4 months. This past year, it's been 6 months. Because of my clear results, I am now onto a full year before I have to go back to my oncologist, which is a great thing for me because my oncologist is an hour and a half away. So it's a 3 hour journey, really, just to get there, and then it's usually an hour of waiting sometimes. So it's a 4 hour adventure, if you like to call it, just for a checkup for them to say, okay, see you later. It's literally how it is. But I wouldn't change it because if anything was wrong, I'd want to know. And I had a recovery in about 8 weeks. I couldn't do anything. Having a shower was exhausting. I didn't realize how much having surgery. I'm like, oh, I'm fit, I can do this. I'll be right back up, bouncing up. I'd have to have a 3 hour nap after having a shower. The first week, going to the bathroom was exhausting. It was a very, very no movable summer. I did stand up for my best friend in her wedding about 7.5 weeks after surgery, 8 weeks, and the running joke was everyone was waiting for me to fall in because I did wear 3-inch stiletto heels, but let me tell you, being cut to hip and having no core and having to stand up there for about an hour, not a good time. But I made it back. There's a little bit of scar tissue in that caused me pain, but I just have to keep working it out, and I just know I have limitation now from certain things, and I go with it. I'd be lying if I didn't say I despise it, I hate it, I don't wish it upon my worst enemy, and that there should be no such word as cancer, and no one in the world should go through it. But unfortunately, this is our reality, and luckily I have been going through normal screenings. It's as easy as going in and asking your doctor for a pap smear or a screening. The now normal, if you have normal cells, is 2 to 5 years. I suggest you fight for those and have them every year at least. Knowing what is going on with your body is so important more than ever. And a simple test can save your life. So if there's one thing you take away from this whole video, it is, go for your tests. Don't be scared of a smear. Having cramps for an afternoon is way better than having the alternative. Most times the symptoms, if there are any, and I'll get to that in a later video, don't even show up. You don't suffer through the symptoms. Mine was I was more tired than normal. That was my only symptom. I could have said that was anything. So how do I feel about it? I felt like I was dreaming. I was hoping I was dreaming and that it was a big nightmare and I was going to wake up. At that point, I would have did anything to make the verdict a different one. Sometimes I go into a really dark place. I'm always gonna have good and bad days, just like everyone else in life. I finally have realized how precious life is and how much I need to make each day count. I have a difficult time with people with their children sometimes. As much as I love them, they're my absolute favorite people in the world. I have learned that I have the most amazing husband, most amazing family, and I have the best gift of all, a little dog I got the day I found out it was cancer-free, named Benson. You'll see in future videos anyone who is a dog lover understands the meaning of a dog, and they know. And he has been my rock. It's been my everything. Physically, I'm honestly stronger than I ever was before. As a woman, you're always told that you're weak and that you can't strive to be anything. And there's a quote that I always go back to. And the quote is, my attitude is that if you push me towards something that you think is my weakness, then I will perceive weakness into a strength. Michael Jordan, of all people. Anytime someone tells me that I'm too small, I don't know how many times I've heard that, I'm 5'2", 110 pounds soaking wet. I've come so far in the past 2 years that I am not going to let cancer define who I am as a person. Who I am? It gives me a daily reminder that change is not going to come overnight. I'm not going to be as strong as I was before and as healthy as I was pretty healthy and fit going into this. That's going to take time to come back. I've lost a lot of mobility in my back. It's coming back. I have a lot of tear and scar tissue in my stomach that my core is never going to be the same as it was. Doesn't mean I was healthier before or after. No, it's just different. Like I just said, it's different. I do have more sensitivity to foods. I get a lot more swollen in my stomach, a lot more digestive issues, but those are things you learn to deal with, and if it means having my life, I'm A-okay with those things. It's been a learning curve, but with apple cider vinegar and probiotics, I've kept it most manageable, and it's just a learning experience, and it'll take time, but I'll get there. If I could even just help one woman know her own strength and that she is stronger than all of this. That cancer doesn't defy who you are as a person. That you are bigger than any of this. You will beat this. We are in this together. As women, we are strong, courageous, and incredible. And I'm here for you, and you have got this. You have the support. I'm making this video because it may help women who are going through a similar situation. Maybe my voice is enough of a reason and give some girls hope that there's more to life than cervical cancer. So I'm ready to tell my story. No one ever wants to be told they have cancer or have to go through treatment for cancer. My story has shaped me and changed me. That not everything in life has to be decided on our weaknesses, but on how we overcome those heartaches. This is where this story ends and my new one begins. I'm going to be starting a series here on YouTube channel called Journey to Happiness. This is going to be a series based on me trying to finding myself and figuring out who I am and knowing I deserve to be happy and that I need to accept what has happened because it cannot be changed and look forward to a bright future with my puppy and my husband and who knows what it may hold. I want to let you know that there is hope at the end of the tunnel. Teal is the real deal. Not all cancers are pink. Being a survivor of cervical cancer symbolizes hope, desire, and love. That we're all in this together. We are a community. We are strong, beautiful women who deserve everything beautiful in life. And I hope this brings awareness to a slowly eaten away disease that's usually put on the back burner. Not that other cancers aren't important, but please, ladies, do these small tests and you could save your life. I hope that we can bring awareness and prevention to this, and hopefully there's a cure that no woman has to go through this, and let alone any type of cancer. So for all of you, let's find hope. Until next time.